So we are very pleased to have you, Yaro, as a part of our project at Oxford, the Oral History of Tibetan Studies, as we call the project. We are very pleased. And I'm going to address you as Yaro, as people know you in Asia, where you have worked a lot, and as they know you anywhere else in the world. So we are very happy to have you. And I would like to ask you about your life, of course. So could we start with the background of your family and with your childhood? Where and when were you born? And how did you grow up?
Well, I was very lucky. I have good karma that I have been born just 1 month after the World War II ended. I was born in Prague, a textile businessman and daughter of a big farmer. But shortly after my birth, my parents moved to northern Bohemia, where my mother came from, because there was a big vacuum after all the Germans were forced out from former Czechoslovakia. And there were good opportunities for business of my father, and the grandparents also could look after the children, their grandchildren. So the first 6 years I have spent in a small town called Lovosice on the River Elbe, where it enters into the narrow valley that opens again in Dresden in Germany. But we have been disowned by the communists in 1948, and we had been also kicked out from our house, and so we moved to neighboring Litoměřice, which is a very historic city on the River Elbe and fantastic located. And there I have spent more or less the coming 20 years. Not so much. I went when I was 17 to study in Prague. So that's northern Bohemia.
So how many siblings did you have?
We were three. One year older sister and 1 2 years younger sister. And as it happened, I was a macho, so I had to know everything better than my 1 year older sister. So I was more or less clinching with her, and the gap to the 2 years younger sister than I was very big. So actually I grew up with my 1 year older sister.
So you went to a standard elementary school?
Well, and up to the baccalaureate, as the communists reformed the schooling. So it was 8 years basic schooling. And then after that, it was divided into, say, what in Czech is called matura, or baccalaureate, and the same was possible also to make in an artistic or technical or scientific direction, but those were 4 years, but I had only 11 years and up to my baccalaureate, and so with 17 I could move to Prague to the Technical University.
And which hobbies did you have as a child?
Well, hobbies. My sister, older sister, she was a reading devil. She learned reading when she was five. So I was four when I had also to learn it. So she was reading a lot. I I was reading slowly, and then she, so there was always a discrepancy between our, what we have read. And so actually sports were my hobbies, but it became very early. I was 9.5 years old when I was given, without asking for it, as a Christmas gift, a box camera, Altista box, using roll film. And fortunately, a close friend of our father, he has shown me how to develop the films and make prints. So I was 10 when my passion to take pictures started. And after short breaks during my studies, it lasted up until today.
Yes, that was your first experience. So what did you like to photograph at the time, at 10 years?
My sister. My sister, then my my friends, boys. But early I was... Today I'm wondering, because I was quite wild. But when I was in 1956, I was 11 years old. So my father allowed me to take his Zeiss icon, super icon, on the excursion we made with our school to Southern Bohemia. So it was already castles and landscapes. I've been taking pictures and developing pictures in that time.
So it was both portraits and landscapes that you still do?
Portraits, not in that sense, as arranged portraits. So somebody was standing in front of the camera, I clicked it, and I was... I started quite early. I was maybe 12 or 13 to sell photographs and to take pictures in the villages around Litoměřice and of baptizings and so on. So I was quite self-sufficient in to practicing my hobby photography very early.
Have these early photographs have ever been shown or published?
Well, published only in my family book I made for the 60th anniversary of taking pictures. The title of the book is a plagiat, because sometimes in the remainders I bought two titles, Kertész and Kertész, and Eisenstadt on Eisenstadt. I worship these great photographers, and they were presenting some of their iconic pictures and told the stories behind which the photographs not show. So I made a book, Jaro on Jaro, and commented from the earliest pictures until the last ones. So but it's not publicly accessible only for the family. Now the digital technology makes it affordable and good quality.
So then you moved to Prague after finishing your high school.
Yes.
And what happened in Prague?
Well, that's same typical communist story, because I was, since I saw Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs back in 1950, my first movie in the life, I was obsessed by cinema going. And I even tried to sneak in into prohibited, for children prohibited movies. But I tried every time I got opportunity. So I wanted to become a cameraman. So I also regarded the photography as a training for camera, movie camera, life, profession. But it should not be misunderstood. In the small town, we were a kind of prodigies. So I never had a B on, except for behavior, on my certificates. And so I could study whatever I wanted, science, languages, because when I was seven, I started with my older sister to learn German, luckily, because father was a cosmopolitan. He said, as many languages you speak, as many lives you live. And so it was fun to learn German, because I picked up also a couple of nasty expressions, and I could use them and spread them among my friends. But it was absolutely hopeless to think of study movie camera at Film Academy in Prague. It was beginning of the 60s. So as my background, family background, father former capitalist, mother daughter of a kulak, that were big farmers, my chance after the baccalaureate was to prove myself, to show myself having good relation to working and farming class, so to go just to work without getting admission. And the danger was that during this approval year, they could also draw me to the army, and that I didn't want. But luckily a cousin of our mother, he could smuggle me into the Faculty of Nuclear Physics. And I was also keen in science. So just shortly before the last grade, before baccalaureate, the book of Robert Jung, Brighter Than Thousand Suns, was published on Project Manhattan. And so I discovered nuclear chemistry as a specialization. And of course, to pass the exams, entry exams, was no problem for me. So I started to study nuclear chemistry at the Faculty of Nuclear Physics. And we had a devilish professor in mathematics. More than 60% did not pass mathematics after the first two terms. But I fell in love with mathematics, and I made it excellent. So when there, after the first year, was a question which specialization I select, I applied for nuclear chemistry, but there were 11 applicants and only 10 free positions. And a friend of mine who was really fighting and just surviving the mathematics, he asked me to take back my application, then he would be safe. So for one beer, I have done it. And so I continued as a nuclear physicist. And so as it happened, I make long story short, luckily I was fluent German when the first contact between communist Prague and university in Cologne took place, and I was the only one who could translate, and so I was one of the participants of the ever first contact between West Germany, capitalist West Germany, and communist Czechoslovakia. And out of it came that I also belonged to the first group of Czechoslovak students who were allowed to accept the DAAD scholarship. And it coincided with my diploma thesis. So I came in 1966, in October, to Aachen, made my diploma thesis in physics, ultrasonics, and luckily I was allowed to take an extension by 1 year to make also the final exams, so-called Hauptexamen in Germany. And then I missed the deadlines for a PhD in the States, because I got the certificate, the master degree certificate, too late. And I was threatened to return to Prague and had to join the army. So when a professor in theoretic physics offered me the possibility to make a PhD with him, I grabbed this theme without knowing what was it about. So I became a theoretical physicist at the end. But as I was working on a theoretical thesis, I had also a lot of time, because I could work somewhere with a pencil and a sheet of paper. And the Institute of Experimental Physics, they had a fantastic photo lab. And so I became again photographer. So I started, I had now Western cameras. It was, I had an excellent scholarship. So I was both in Germans, Rückfällig, and photography. So I started to take pictures for newspapers in Aachen, and so it came.
Yeah, very interesting. And what did you find interesting about studying physics, nuclear physics to start with, and then theoretical physics?
Actually, if we should go into that detail, I was more interested in chemistry. But when the younger brother of our mother and uncle, I liked very much, and it great respect. When he asked me what I would study after the baccalaureate, I said chemistry. He was a machinery engineer and fanatic with machinery, and working in a chemical combinator, so was a big company in the neighboring town. So he said, with your brain, it's a waste. Chemists can become everybody who can count to 10. And so I said, phew. But luckily I heard shortly after that about nuclear chemistry. So I said, when I saw him next time, I said, no, I changed my mind. I would study nuclear chemistry. And he did not know what it is. So I explained to him. For that reason, I also bought the university textbook on nuclear chemistry and worked it through. So when I really then applied, I had some notion what ahead of me. But physics was actually more interesting. I have been always tossed through the life. Had an idea, then something was offered to me that I liked more. I took the chances.
What did you like so much about photography, about the visual dimension of physics, well, let's say?
As I said, my parents supported us tremendously. What they had to do, just to offer to three of us the opportunities, music, you know, sports, travels, and so on. And under the communism, it was really something that was tough job. So they had to work black works nighttime just to give us the chances. And so I was also given abonnement of Czechoslovak photography, I think monthly. And so I have learned about the great masters. So Cartier-Bresson, I was 10, 11 when I first time, I could not pronounce it, but I was familiar with Cartier-Bresson, Werner Bischoff, Curtis, Sudek, also all the great Czech names. So I was reading the articles on composition in photography, but I said, when I'm big, I will do my rules. So with the result that nowadays I would write literally the same text on photographic composition of photographs. I was quite attentive to see among the friends of father who were photographers, they have shown me, you should create a viewfinder by your fingers. And when you think it would be a picture, close one eye, because your camera has also only one eye. So I learned very early. I was in the early teens, a kind of craft, photographic craft. And I was 15 or 16 when I mixed first time color, the chemistry for color photography. So, and made color photographs, of course, with no result presentable, but it was a thrill.
Okay, so then you came to Germany and so you started working for newspapers and it just happened.
Occasionally sports and just street photography.
But still, why did you find the visual aspect of life so interesting?
Well, that's still the mystery of life. Someone does it, the most other people don't do it. Some are gifted for music. I was more interested in visual arts.
And then you became teaching at university in Köln. You were employed.
Yeah.
So how did that happen?
Well, with two friends of mine, in 1971, after all three had our degrees, we went on a planned one-year trip to Africa. We planned actually, the original idea planned to go to Cambodia, to Angkor, but it was technically not possible. So we went to Africa and accidentally, a friend of mine in Aachen, he asked me one day, would you be interested to work as a freelance photographer for the German press agency on your trip? I said, well, yes. I didn't dare think of something like that. He said, my uncle is the boss of the DPA, as it is, the abbreviation in German, in Düsseldorf. So I asked him when he would be able to see you, show him your work. I think it's very good. And maybe you could be the photographer on your trip. So I went to Düsseldorf, spread out my photographs, and he, from the beginning, he called me Dottore. And so, Dottore, yes, do our works. We will send films to you to care of embassies. You will send by hotline, airbag, the exposed films. You write the stories and see what comes out. Golden days for press agencies and material. Golden days. So on this journey, I did some good photographs, but we all had not money enough for the trip. It lasted only 9 months. We came, after 9 months, back to Germany, broke, so I needed money. And when I was sending out application to diverse companies where I could work as a physicist, I was immediately rejected because of my close relation to communist Czechoslovakia. If there were nuclear physics, nuclear power plants, everything, where was an involvement of high tech, the risk of espionage was too big. So luckily my prof in Aachen, the old Schlögl, he gave me half job for the time as I was looking for a job. And I never was thinking of teaching, and I had no great opinion of teachers anyway. And one day I read an announcement in Frankfurter Allgemeine that Fachhochschule Köln, Fachbereich, Department of Imaging Sciences, Photoengineering, they look for a professor in physics and optics. I did not fulfill the basic conditions. I was no German citizen. I was not working after my degree for 5 years in any photographic industry, which was a precondition. But I applied, and it was my work for the German press agency that they decided for me if I first get German citizen. Until then, I would not be full professor, but only employed as a professor. So I said, okay, the payment was not too bad. And some lectures, you know, why not? And I needed the money, and nobody wanted me otherwise. So I started in February 1973 as a, for the time, teacher of physics and optics in Cologne.
You were very young at the time.
Well, I was short ahead of 28. So, and it worked. And after 1 or 2 years, I saw it was like jackpot in Lotto, at the job, because the equipment in photography and so everything was at my disposal. I was, from one day to the other, I was more or less a professional photographer regarding all equipment. And when I, 4 years later, started to make documentaries, we were also having a department of cinematography and of videography or TV technology. So the Fachhochschule Köln, the University of Applied Sciences, became my life at the end. So from 1981, more or less, all my projects became projects of the university, and I'm sure that the ANCO project and ALCI project more or less made me eligible to use the university after my retirement.
Yeah, it quite paid off that they hired you at that time. And at that time you were already settled in Germany, you felt here like at home? Or how was it coming to a new country, to go back a bit? How was it difficult or easy to...
Well, I haven't seen my parents for 7 years. They were allowed to come to visit me only, 1977. Myself had to wait until 1990. So, needless to say that from the beginning I was in Aachen, in Germany. I used the opportunity to travel. So, London and Paris are more or less anteportas. So, they were before the first rate of the scholarship was paid, I went to Rome with two friends of mine by a VW Beetle. So I was in the West, I was feeling like in a paradise. I was passionate hiker at home. So I knew every hill around Litoměřice within 40 kilometers. And so now the world was open. It was just to get the idea. I was also very well paid. As a professor, I had 3 months vacations in the summer, 1 month in the winter, 2 weeks Christmas time. So I could start really thinking of projects in the far world.
And you found friends as well? You found a community here?
Oh, yes, of course. When I came to Germany, I was German speaking, so that was nothing. I even did not need to pass any German exam, as usually all foreign students have to do. So I have, and you must imagine that the Czechs and the Germans, they had 1,000 years of mutual history. And I grew up in Sudeten. So, and my professor with whom I made a PhD, he was one of the Sudeten Deutsche. You know, and his grandfather was mayor in Litoměřice. So how should you not feel like at home when you are surrounded Aachen, a university city, 10,000 students and 200,000 population, culture? No, I was never a minute homesick. I don't know the term by my own experience on the literature.
And so how was it to be a professor? So you started teaching?
Yes.
And how was it? Did you like teaching?
Actually, yes. not only that what you have to do, you should do with pleasure. I liked it. I had in every year, I had a group of nice students. It was there was a response, and later when I started to give also a seminar on Slitsken and panoramic photography, and that was also the pool of students for my projects in Asia. So there are also friendships I still maintain with former students who finished their study 30. Just last week, a student who was with me in the first semester, so in summer semester 1973, and he called me to tell me that he inspired by me, studied physics, and his two sons also studied physics. I said, well, and he also, like you used to say, that physics is the best to study because as a physicist, you can do everything. And so I have reminded your words.
So, and yes.
It's true.
That's your impact. And what exactly did you teach?
Well, luckily, basic physics. So in physics, I had also no graduation works, a diploma thesis. So I had very special subjects regarding optics, more optics, nothing actually in physics. I can't tell you now the titles of the thesis, but later in Angkor, the students made a dozen at least, if not more, diploma theses on subjects connected with the conservation and restoration of cultural relics.
Yeah.
So. It's
wonderful. And you also mentioned that you went to Africa in 71 and 72. And how do you remember this trip?
Well, actually, it really changed my life. Then I became more or less land and people photographer. German press agency was very, very happy with the results. And I luckily was at the right time there. It was 10 years after the most countries we passed through gained their independence. In Congo, it was tough, very tough, because the 10 years they didn't do anything about roads, and just to get through the country was a nightmare and not photogenic. So I made quite nice portraits. And what was really then important, we were flexible to change our route. And when we learned in Uganda from a German employee at the embassy about the Arab dhows sailing from East Africa to Persian Gulf, and when we learned about Yemen, that changed our goal. So we sold the car, VW van, and traveled to Yemen. And later, I have probably done most detailed documentation of Yemeni architecture that exists. I have been visiting for 40 years Yemen, not as intensely as Southeast Asia, but
so
a couple of journeys came together, and Africa was also first the experience that my life is in Asia.
What does it mean that your life is in Asia?
Well, I devoted 90% of my time to Asia. It started with the Himalayas, with the Ladakh, then continued with India. I just descended from the mountains to the down country, then Tibet, and then after 20 years of intense work on Indian subcontinent, I moved to Southeast Asia, to Angkor, so Burma. So I have had small projects in Europe, France, Italy, so no question, but my life I've devoted to South Asia and Central Asia.
And you
I was for 1 year in Afghanistan after my retirement.
And you came to Asia via Africa and Yemen.
Well,
in fact,
we also met a missionary in Ethiopia, a German missionary, who just came from a holiday trip or business trip to North Yemen. And there was him who told us about Sada, and he was so enthusiastic, and he said, here in Africa, it's boring. The right terrain for you is Asia. And we didn't make it to Hadramaut as we wanted, because in those days politically it was impossible. It was also a communist regime. And so we were at the attempt to get to Hadramaut. We were caught by the police, and they have expelled us to North Yemen, luckily. And so I had actually no other option after 1972 than to turn my attention to Aisha.
And what did you like so much about Yemen?
I never, afterwards, after the trip to Yemen, never visited a country that was really so genuine, so middle-aged. You must imagine, until 1962, until the rule of the Imam, there were only few dozens visitors from the West. There were no roads. There were one road from Hudaydah to Sanaa, otherwise nothing. So that was a place where we could make more or less still discoveries. To get from Sanaa to Sada, some 200 kilometers, it was in those days 250 kilometers cross country on a truck. And the Arabs, when they accept you as a guest, they show you the utmost hospitality and sincerity. So it was, of course, difficult to talk with them. Nobody spoke a word English, and we didn't speak Arabic, but we learned quickly to say Aleman Tama. That means German, good. And it was Aleman Tama, Tamam Vannus. And so.
So that's why you say Inshallah. If I ask you, if I can meet you.
Yeah, Inshallah. I'm a total atheist, but I do not spoil anything using Inshallah.
And was there a place that you really like in Africa, in the continent of Africa?
The most interesting country was Ethiopia, definitely.
And why?
The landscape and also the people. The most beautiful people. I can't help me. I haven't been there a second time. The only country I was twice after that, including the trip, was Cameroon. And besides the journey, I also went to Mali, 1982, to shoot a documentary on architecture of clay. Djenné, where there concrete is stubble, was the title of the film.
Then after Yemen, you decided to go to Asia.
Well, from Yemen, we flew back to East Africa, and then we took an Arab dhow and sailed from Kenya to Oman. That was, of course, quite a unique experience. Not many Westerners did it at all. I think there were only four or five of us that made the trip on a genuine Arab dhow, a trade that existed for millenniums. Plinius the Elder already described the travels of the Arab dhows from Shatt al-Arab to East African coast.
So how was it? How was it?
Exciting, yes. That's what, and, well, the landscape on sea is boring. All the blue and one line. But the crew were Persian, the Arab dhow, so Kuwaiti boom, the kind of the boat, was registered in Bandar Abbas, and it was 3 weeks, three of us and 15 crew living on dates, fish, rice, and chapati, observing tuna fish, flying fish, a whale. Mm-hmm. It was, of course, interesting. No.
And it was in 72.
In 1972. From Lamu to Oman. Oman was still almost untouched. The Sultan was in power since 1 year. So that when the country started to modernize.
So how did you find Oman? So you landed?
We spent 1 week there. We didn't travel outside of Matra and Muscat. I was only there. And in a way, it was, in comparison with Yemen, nothing so exciting. It was interesting anyway. And I had a little task from the museum director in Lamu in Kenya to look if we happen to land, because it was said that every 10 dhows never reached the destination. If you reach Oman, look after door frames of Lamu origin. So I have found a couple of them, made photographs, and later sent it.
And where did you continue afterwards?
Well, that was in a way cul-de-sac. Because we had no visa for all further countries, and there in those days was still the British-English shipping company running with MS Dwarka from Bombay and Khorramshahr, Basra and Khorramshahr. So with the help of a German company was building the new port in Muscat, the shipping company accepted us as passenger to get to Iran. And luckily, the uncle of one of us was working for the Hansa Line, which was based in Khorramshahr or Ibadan, and they borrowed us money to get home. So then we needed 1 week from Persian Gulf to get to Germany and start a serious life.
And so when did you return to the East the next time?
Well, and then my sister, my older sister, she emigrated to Mexico. So 1973, my first vacation as teacher, I of course had to go and see her and also to take photographs of the new country where the daughter of my parents lived. So I made with a friend of mine from Cologne, a German Chilean, we made a 3 month trip to Mexico and Guatemala. I was again working for German press agency, but what happened was that later the cleaning woman at the German press agency office in Düsseldorf mistakenly disposed, threw in the garbage all my black and white negatives from Mexico, Guatemala. So I did not lose all the pictures because I was so keen to print some of them and also to send them to my parents to show Mexico to them, that before the material was edited in the DPA office, I made 2 sets of about 90 pictures. They survived, the negatives, they landed in garbage. And then the DPA, it was a quite well known in the circles of DPA, known scandal what happened. And the boss who helped me more or less to get the job at Fachhochschule, he offered a settlement that I don't sue them, but they would pay for 3 trips and I keep the copyright of the photographs. Otherwise it was shared copyright 50-50. I said, it's a deal. So he asked me, do you have an idea? First step, I said, Japan. That was the most expensive country I could think of. And I knew Tokaido Road since I was a little boy, because my father collected matchbook labels and he had Hiroshigo's watercolors on matchboxes. So, and said, okay. And shortly afterwards, the Japanese recognized diplomatically Mao, Red China. So Taiwan canceled landing rights for Japan Airlines, so Japanese Air. And of course, the German press agency sold my soul to Japan Airlines. And Japan Airlines was now making millions of dollars losses per day. So they have canceled all these projects on mutuality with press agencies, photographers, authors. So the boss of DPA asked me, what is the next? What is the alternative? So I said, Kashmir. So it happened. So he sold my soul to Air India. So I made photographs of Kashmir, that one. I knew since my childhood, because I had a Kashmir show, what we called Kashmir show. Not what was not a Kashmir show, but it was called generally in Czechoslovakia, Kashmir shows. So I wanted to see Kashmir. And I read in Anzaka and Sigmund on Kashmir.
And was it your first time in India?
Yes, of course. Going east.
So that was 76?
74.
74, sorry.
Well, and again, at the Technical University in Aachen, where I wrote my thesis in theoretical physics, four floors above me was the Institute of Geography. And I befriended Willibald Hafner, who was working fanatically on the geography of Nepal. And he became professor of geography in Gießen. Shortly after that, I became professor in Cologne. So he told me, Jaro, now you can travel only during the vacations between the summers, and it's not good for Nepal Himalaya. You should look to the West Himalaya and Karakoram, Ladakh. It's not affected so much by monsoon. So that's first time I heard about Ladakh on the map called Little Tibet. So belongs to Jammu and Kashmir. So that was clear that my Kashmir project would also include, if possible, Ladakh.
So you went there to both Kashmir and Ladakh in 74?
Well, yes. And it's it's again my good karma, you know. I have asked at the Indian embassy in Bonn for the permission to the restricted area of Ladakh. The bastards, they didn't even reply the letter. So we landed with my then girlfriend, later my wife. We landed in Delhi, very accommodated in YMCA, close to Janpat, and on Janpat at the beginning is a tourist office of India. So first day I walked there just to ask where to go to get the inner line permit for Ladakh. And the lady said, but Saab, Ladakh was open 2 weeks ago. I said, come on, I don't believe it. Yes, we have been informed by Ministry of Home Affairs just 2 weeks ago. I said, please show me the letter. So I was really insisting. It took some time to find the letter, but I saw it black on white. The Srinagar Leh road up to Upshi is open to visitors and 1 mile north of it. Wow, really. We hurried up to Srinagar, to Kashmir. Mm-hmm. And first I had to do my work also on Kashmir. So it was very impressive and beautiful. Kashmir is very, very exciting place. When I went to the bus stand to ask how to get to Leh, everybody said, what's up? Impossible for foreigners. I said, no, it's now possible since 2 weeks. and we don't believe it. So then I went to the Office of Information Office of India, so my name card and so on. I said, yes, sir, we have received the same information you have seen in Delhi. I should inform the Road Transport Corporation of Jammu and Kashmir that now they also can accept foreigners as passengers. But at the same moment, an earthquake started. The man just finished the sentence, he ran for the door. I didn't notice that the tremor was on. From the door, he turned back, sir, follow me, earthquake. So we ran down in the yard. After 2 minutes, nothing serious happened. He said, now we can go and continue our talk. So
you must have been one of the very first foreigners, or maybe the first one on that 50. Route.
Yeah, because at that time, when you arrived in the Bazaar of Land, there was a chap from secret police who is a Guancho. He had a book of visitors and you had to enter everything. So I think I had 30 plus number registration. But I had to exercise patience, because when I have bought guidebooks on Kashmir, in one of the guidebooks, I came across Amarnath Yatra. And there was only, and to the cave of Amarnath with the ice lingam in August, during the full moon, tens of thousands of pilgrims. I said, 10,000? 3 days walking through the Himalaya, crossing a pass for 4,500. It must be spectacular. Never heard and seen of it. So, and it was just 10 days later. So, Ladakh can wait. They will not cancel the permission this summer, at least. So I went first to Amarnath Yatra.
And what did you like so much about photographing and documenting festivals and these special events? Because even afterwards, you have been coming back to it.
I made also a documentary.
Yes.
Long march to salvation, Shiva's pilgrims in the Himalayas. Well, that's life. That's life. Festivals.
Special times and places.
Oktoberfest or Amarnath Yatra. It's spectacular always. People express themselves. I'm not philosophical about it. I just participate and take pictures. And
when you photograph people, do you think that you somehow have a special relationship to them, and or that you are able to reflect them in order to be able to do this?
Well, as I said, I'm absolutely non-philosophical. And I'm also not interpreting my pictures. I do the pictures for myself. And if they say something to other people, it's my great pleasure. But I have now a room full of pictures. Beside me, nobody has seen.
So when you take pictures for yourself, is it, what is it about? So there's an aesthetical dimension.
Yes.
But there's also, yes, but there's also a background to it. Like the cultural context and maybe your person inside.
Not until the 1980s, actually. When I have started to document the early Buddhist wall paintings in the Himalayas, I even did not think that my photographs one day become documents. And I was interested in the historical photographs only as an illustration of the travel and discovery books. That the value of a photograph can change. It can also happen that you photograph somebody and he is shot by an idiot next day. So you have made a document for his relations of him and so on.
How did you come to Ladakh afterwards, after Kashmir?
Well, I was waiting for the Amarnath Yatra and met, coincidentally, in a bookshop, the principal of School of Buddhist Philosophy in Choklamsar, Mr. Mato, who informed me that I will not find a single book on Ladakh in entire Kashmir. He named only Cunningham's Ladakh from 1857 or so. He said there are 2 buses weekly, gave a minutious description of the road, name of the places, everything, really detailed briefing. And when I had the briefing and his exciting descriptions of Lama Yuru and Pyong and everything, all the places, I had no idea how it, I had only the picture of Leh Castle vividly in front of my eyes. I said, you must find a way to not to travel on bus there. And at the Dal Lake, I saw 2 German vans with German license numbers. So I gave screen wipe notice, could we meet tonight? Got some beer. And I told him with red ears and excited, Ladakh. So it took me really a couple of years and talking like a book that they say, okay, we come with you to Ladakh, Taj Mahal can wait. And of course, I pay for the fuel and all expensive if we stay overnight. I pay for everything. And so I traveled on a Ford Transit with 4 German. We were some 6 people. We traveled by car to the crossing Sojela, spending night in Kargil. The ever first stopover in Kargil. I took a lot of pictures and I liked it. It was exciting.
And how was Kargil at this time?
It was
time?
Exciting. Unfortunately, we had to start at 3 in the morning to pass ahead of military convoy, so behind them or so. But every other stopover in Kargil was a pain in the ass. But the first time, I saw first Ladakh with the typical hairdress, you know, shaved and long hair. I have a nice portrait of him. Even the Muslims, they were as curious as we were, you know, gazing at each other. Well, and then on the second day in the evening, we reached land. Of course, Lamayuru was it's fantastic. And we had been offered hospitality by the principal of the school of Buddhist philosophy. His house full of bed bugs, like every house in Ladakh and Zanskar in coming years. That was really always painful with the bed bugs. And well, then we visited the valley around Leh on the next 2 days altogether, and they said, okay, so we have seen it, now we find, we go to Taj Mahal, cheers,
and quite far gone, away.
Where are they? And you know what consequence is that for me?
You had no way out.
I was just in last August there again, and probably last, I'm not sure. But there are so many close friends now.
And why is Ladakh so interesting for you that you keep returning? You've also said somewhere, I think, that it is the most fascinating place for you, of the Himalayas at least?
Well, the firstborn child has also certain privileges of the firstborn. So it was 1974, really a little Tibet. It was like in a dream. It's the country then and now have, of course, in common the fantastic people. The people, the character of the people can't be changed by caste and even shortly by smartphones. And because of my photography, bring some photographic report, I had to go also to meet people to ask for facts. So I met the lawyer there just to talk about the criminality, because it was that there is no criminality in Ladakh, population of 100,000, as big as the former GDR. You know? So I needed facts. So I started to meet people. I met the then living king, you know. And I'm not a journalist, but the curiosity and to get the information so I can ask somebody, then use it and maybe write a readable text. So it was not clear that I would come again, because I was since 1 year only at the university. I was thinking maybe it would not be so bad to get a job of staff photographer with Stern magazine or some of the big illustrated magazines. But while driving along the Indus to Leh, I got the crazy idea that would be fantastic to go in a boat on the Indus. That surely was not done before. So rafting on the Indus. So 1 year later, I came with a boat.
A raft.
To raft on the Indus. So it became the Indo-German Indus expedition. Again, very lucky about the timing. In 1975, Indira Gandhi declared emergency, total censorship of press. So the expedition, Indo-German expedition, first drafting of the name-giving river of India, and nominally I appointed the leader, an Indian called Kumar, who was obsessed by publicity. So for 1 week, we made the headlines. All newspapers, we were on TV, there was a journalist and companions. And so that was the second time. But again, I heard that road is being built to Zanskar from Kargil. So I said, I should arrive before the first car there. I never been in my life in a capital where there was no car before me there. So I asked my friend from the Indus expedition, would you come next year to Zanskar? Oh, where is it? Oh, yeah, let's do it. And so 1976, I was again in Ladakh, in Zanskar. When we arrived in Ladakh, we heard Dalai Lama is coming for Kalachakra. Oh, what is Kalachakra? Dalai Lama, I knew who it is. So when we reached, after our trekking, Lamayuru, it was white, being whitewashed, you know. Dalai Lama coming in 10 days. And he will spend the night there. So my friend had to return to Germany, but I still could stay. So I want to see the Kalachakra, to be with it. So, 77, I did not come.
Okay, so you started a career as a professor and also as a photographer. And what about your first exhibitions of photography?
Well, the first exhibition was in cafeteria in Faculté des Sciences in Paris, in Orsay, where my friend Peter Meyer just started to work on his doctoral thesis. And so he exhibited my Paris photographs and Africa photographs. That must be around 1974, 73. And then the next one was here in Germany, in the neighborhood of Cologne, in Brühl, my first Ladakh and Zanskar works. And then exhibition came and came. Yeah. So there were, meanwhile, quite many.
So people liked your exhibitions, the first one and the second one. People came to see it.
Well, if I say yes, it's probably not modest enough. But in a way, the people must like my work because they would not ask me to make the exhibition.
And did you also take part in competitions of photography?
Photographic competitions, that's red cloth for me. Because the first time I took part was as a 13 years old boy in the communist organization in Czechoslovakia, and the creativity of youth should have been supported. So I made a CV of my best, but no recognition. So, but okay, I was a little boy. But when I just became professor here in Cologne, and the next year was the first Fotokina while I was professor. So I was persuaded by a colleague of mine who was professor in creative photography to participate. So I have participated with 3 photographs and of course there were some 10,000 contributors as I learned later, and I didn't make the big prize, but I have been included in the exhibition of 100 best of the competition. And the competition was not anonymous. Respectively, my colleague who was in the jury and his friend, the Pope of German photography, Fritz Gruber, who also founded Fotokina shows and so on, they knew who submitted what among the photographers, they knew. So I was wondering that among the 100 was one of mine and 4 other works of people who were friends of both the jurors. So then I made a vow, not again. And until now, I did not participate in any contest.
So when we talk about your initial years as a photographer, which camera did you use when you went to Africa, when you were in Germany?
In Africa, I had a 35mm Asahi Pentax Spotmatic 2, which was at that time very, very famous, popular camera. And a friend of mine could bring the equipment from Japan, which saved more than 50%. So then in Ladakh, the 300mm lens was stolen from me. So I heard about Olympus OM1 and about how much better it should be than my Spotmatic. So thanks to German press agency, I could buy completely new equipment of Olympus cameras and accessories through Japan Airlines press department. So I switched over to Olympus, and since then I'm a faithful Olympus photographer. So 35mm I have done all with Olympus. OM2 was the most useful camera for me.
And when you went to Ladakh for the first time, I think you had the Russian camera FT2.
No. The Russian panoramic camera I took first time on my trip to the Himalayas in 1976. Because I had a really big need to make panoramas. I knew since I turned my attention to the Himalayas, of course I looked in all the books from the beginning of the 20th century on Hindu Kush, Karakoram, Himalayas, Tibet, and I found that all the Italian expeditions, they made panoramas. The workmen who discovered Siachen Ridge, they made panoramas. Even Alexandra David Neil had in her bag when she went to Lhasa a panoramic camera. And when I saw the panoramas of Karakoram and Himalaya, I thought, I must take a panoramic camera on the next trip, and it was in the summer 76, just to cope with this landscape. Because every photograph I took until then of the landscape, it told only half of the truth. There was not a context of the motif I had in my mind. So since 76, I was more or less a fanatic panorama photographer. And it was not like Alexander Neil, David Neil, or the Italian photographers who were using Kodak panorama cameras, different size of negatives. I ironically took a Russian FT2, so a refugee of the Russian invasion has had to use a Russian make. But 40 years, it did help me.
And in Ladakh, you came to work on Alchi, on one of the most preserved pieces of architecture in Tibet we have. How did you come to work on it? How did then the book that all people, in fact, in Tibetan studies know, how did it came about?
Well,
and when did you first?
I was very lucky that on the Amarnath Yatra, 1974, before I went to Ladakh, I bumped into Romil Varma, same age Indian photographer from a very prominent family, interested in mountaineering and photography. And because of his prominence, he got a permit to travel to Leh in 1973. And started to work on a book on Ladakh. And Thompson Hudson was about to publish it, but it didn't come up to that. And we met, and he also came later while I was in Ladakh in Leh. He came there, and I was so enthusiastic about the Buddhist art, the first I'd seen beside that one in Museum of East Asian Art here. And he told me, oh, Ponsar, you can forget it all. You must see first Alchi. Ah, what then? And we happened and to travel back to Srinagar on the same, we shared a jeep. And so we dropped in on the way back to Srinagar at Alchi. And when he directed his torch on the green Tara in the sunset, I was lost. Love at first sight. And so whenever I came later to Ladakh and got the opportunity also to drop in at Alchi, so I did it. And when in 1980, I made a documentary on the river Indus from the mouth up to where I got on Indian territory. Alchi had to be included because the Alchi temples are directly rising above the river Indus. So through the valley of river Indus, the Buddhist culture was spreading east and west and transported. So I managed in 1980 to make, I think so, first technically perfect photographs of the miniature paintings, and we filmed them on trick table then as inserts. And the cameraman and producer of our film, Wolfgang Kohl, said when we were molested by crowds of tourists, the road up to the temple was completed in that very summer. He said, we should not only take pictures what is interesting for our documentary, it should be documented all completely, because if the tourism will become worse, you don't know what could happen to all these precious paintings. I said, are you crazy? Hundreds of square meters, miniature paintings, it's not an easy project. And he said, you know people, you find surely a solution. So I took the pictures one day we made for the film and presented it to Roger Gopa, the then director of East Asian Art Museum in Cologne, and asked him, in your opinion, would be interested to document the wall paintings? So we do it. So I said, then we do it next, we start next summer. And then we came in 1981, first time with all photographic equipment and so on and so on. So the ALCI project started.
Can you remind me, I think the book on ALCI was published
by Serenia in 1996.
Yes, with Anton Eris.
Yeah.
So how did this develop? So it was a project, in fact, based in Germany.
Well, and it meanwhile, came from... when the book was published in 1996, I already knew Anton and Mary Lowe for 15 years. So before that, we published the bas reliefs from Angkor Wat. So it was not the first cooperation, but we had a very close friendship for many years before we published together anything. So I met Anthony, and through Anthony also Michael, through John Stewart. I bumped into John Stewart, a very high-grade photographer. I bumped into him at the airport in Leh in 1981 when I came for the Mato Milan with the Lars. And I was hauling my camera box and tripod and the equipment. And in those days, security, everything relaxed, close to the airport. I was standing a chap and he asked me, for whom? I said, for myself, no, for whom? Because he also had a lot of equipment. He said, I do photographs for Snellgrove, for his Ladakh. Oh, really? I said, my name is John Stewart, my name is Jaro Ponsa. He had to board, took off, and that was how we met. In the summer where we were working first time in the ALCI temples, one day John Stewart showed up. He came just from Zanskar, where he was taking for the planned book with Snellgrove more photographs. And he was actually a great commercial photographer. So we had studio lines and so on. So he had fun to help us, to work with us for 3 days or 4 days. And then we became friends. And when I came later that year to London to visit him, he invited for the same dinner Anthony and Mary Lowe. So we became friends.
So how did the work on the ALCI book look like then with Serindia, with Anthony?
Well, he published before that the Tibetan Medical Paintings, a stunning publication. And I, because in 1994 our Safe ALCI project came to its end, it's another story. So we completed the documentation, and there was, of course, now time to publish it, because it was really the first documentation, complete documentation of ALCI. And I have insisted that the book has the same size like the Tibetan Medical Paintings. And he said, well, if it is so, then I need some financial support. And luckily, the Orient Foundation, concrete, Hans Siegel, gave a lost subsidy of 100,000 Deutschmark to publish. He was with us twice in Alchi and loved the place too. And so we started to work on the Alchi book. We came two or three times with Roger Gepper to London, where we're staying with Marie-Laure and Anthonia, and working with Misha on the design. Was still, you must imagine, it came out in 96 and Photoshop came to the market in 95. So it was still this very big book made in classical way, produced in Hong Kong. It was quite a feat.
And so what was the most difficult, the most challenging?
Most challenging, you know, when I, at that time, I have made only, more or less only two books. And in the first cases, I did not practice to make the print check, a sort of press check. But it was difficult to make the corrections of the proofs, wet proofs made in Hong Kong, shipped via London to Cologne, to comment it by comments on the paper. And it was, the result is excellent, but as you know, I work with Christian Lutzanitz on the new edition, two volumes, and now we have all the imaging technology, creatives with Photoshop, InDesign, everything to our disposal. And the printing has improved so much. So I would need now maybe two proofs, and then we could send all the 800 or 1,000 images, send it off to the printing machine, and with enormous result.
And how do you remember Anthony and Michael Eris as people, as friends?
Well, I met a couple of occasions, Michael, because when, and also their mother, who was a stepmother, the painter. So we had nice time, drinks, and we were talking about subjects we devoted our lives to. So it's difficult. So I have done some minor works for Michael, slight duplicating and similar, because it was so easy for me technically to do it. So I assisted him at some technical questions. But with Anthony, as he, for instance, and Marie-Laure, they came in 1994 to visit me in Alchi. So it was my 20th anniversary of coming to Ladakh, so we had a big party in Alchi, in the guest house. Marie-Laure is a good hiker. Anthony was a heavy smoker. So, and we had a lot of fun together.
And could you say more about the Save Alchi project?
Well, when we in 1989 completed the documentation, I came with a team to students from my department, one young architect, Roger Goepa, and we took as much as we could cover in 1 month, and we had before that already 3 working periods in Aichi. The camp of the Likir monastery, when we gave a donation for the monastery school, thank him for support of our works, he said we should not only document, but we also should help them to preserve the paintings. So we said we shall do what we can. And luckily, the Fachhochschule Cologne had a new department of restoration and conservation of cultural relics. And the founding dean was himself a restorer of wall paintings. So at that time I was also dean. So when I approached him whether he would be interested to do some conservation works in Ladakh with his students, he caught fire and said, okay, let's do it. So we started the Save Aichi project in 1991. And it was more complicated than it sounds, not only the fundraising, but the ASI, the Archaeological Survey of India, who actually caused the many damages we should know more or less straighten again, was not in a good relation with the monks of Likir. So we, one hand, we had to sign an MOU with ASI about collaboration in Aichi, and the monks suspected that the collaboration would lead into takeover by ASI. So at the end, in 1994, when we wanted to take a very urgent measure in Sunsek on the third floor, where the one face was dangerously bulging, they didn't allow us to do it. So my friend and colleague said, then we have to withdraw, because if something would happen, the reputation of our department would be ruined. This is, you restore the chorten and don't see that the mandala is falling on your head. What experts are you? So then it was the end of Save Aichi project. We did some minor works in the chortens, both the big and so, but we also needed time to test our methods, because it's not easy to conserve all paintings on clay, and nobody had so far experience with it. The local people and the monks, they would just scratch the painting away and paint it anew. So we have tested for 2 years a method, then did some cleaning in the chortens, and then in 1993, in the small chorten, inside the big chorten, 2 of the monks were conserved. No retouching of missing parts. That was also not our theme, because we said if the monk would insist on retouching, we would do it on their behalf, but from the conservationist point of view, no retouching, only conservation is our objective.
And you also worked at many other monasteries and, in the Himalayas.
Well, Thabo, complete documentation, Toli, and Mustang.
So how was it similar and how was it different? Was there the same difficulties?
Not in 1984, I was in Thabo with Roger Gerpa. We had a special permit granted by Indira Gandhi, so we were not allowed to take any outdoor picture, only inside. And then I was invited by Deborah Klimbok Sota in 2000 to make the Thabo documentation. And before that, in 1993, she invited me to perform the documentation of the wall paintings in Tolling. And as in Tolling, it was also an official collaboration between University of Vienna and the Social Academy in Lhasa. So there were no formal problems, only technical. And in those days, we had Polaroids. We could use Polaroid to see how is the light setting and so, but you could not see whether the 35mm cameras still are working properly, which they sometimes did not.
And what did you like about the places, about Thabo and Tolling?
Well, of course, the landscape is fantastic. It's very exciting. The Satluj Valley at Tolling and Sapara. That's very special. Then Mustang. The Luri Cave Temple. And the Lomantang, the Tupchen. The other than the environment is breathtaking, not because of the altitude, but it's so rare. I prefer it much more than the Eastern Himalayas, where everything is green. It's like in Switzerland.
Yeah, so you prefer deserted landscapes.
Desert and mountains.
And the reason would be aesthetics, the experience.
Yeah. Well, it's exciting to look through the macro lens at a good illumination, because at the beginning we had no portable generator, so we had to work in Alchi with truck batteries and converters. Oof. So it was not such easy, but from 1983 on, there were also in India portable generators available. And when you have light where any visitor doesn't see anything, and I enjoy art quite a lot, and this art in particular.
Yeah, what do you like about Tibetan aesthetics?
Well, actually, the paintings I documented for almost 20 years are not Tibetan. They are either Kashmiri or of unknown origin as Thabo, but Indo-Tibetan.
Yeah, it's Indo-Tibetan, right.
And also in Mustang. So So far, I'm not so familiar and also not so fanatic about the later there are tankas, all tankas, excellently painted. But I'm a perfect atheist. I'm not interested in any mystical or religious meaning of the paintings. I take it purely from the aesthetic side.
And you also made several trips to Tibet when you visited Central and Eastern Tibet, beginning in 85, I think.
In East Tibet, I was only on my first trip in the summer 85. Luckily, the Chinese put Lhasa on the accessible cities in 84. In the fall of 84. They did not think of it how to reach Lhasa because they thought the foreigners are not such idiots and would travel by road, because if then they fly or the low class, they would ride on bus and truck. So there were two reasons to go in the summer 85. To Lhasa and to Tibet. The first was, of course, to go to Lhasa. But at the same time, Indoculture Tours got the permission to take first group to Mount Kailash. And they asked me whether I would join the group. The price was 25,000 Swiss francs, not the travel budget of my expeditions. But when I asked Olympus to sponsor me, they said, yes, if you deliver 10 lectures, first trip to Mount Kailash. You organize it, we pay the organization expenses, but you make the organization and you give the lectures, 10 lectures. So I said, that's a deal. So I met the group on 1st of August in 85 in Lhasa. And luckily at the time we had one student with a scholarship from China, and he was from Sichuan. So I asked him whether he would be my assistant and interpreter on the way to Lhasa. He was more than happy to earn money, to visit his family, and also to go to Tibet. So we started our trip in Dazhou, where he was from, and traveled on buses and trucks up to Chamdo, and then the Xizang Highway, also the Tibet Highway, was severely interrupted in many places. So there was only the possibility to take the northern route from Chamdo, which was really an adventure. But when we traveled up to Lhasa, only in Chamdo, there were few remains of the old monastery, and the monks just started to rebuild it. But Kanze and other Gerze was at that time also not damaged, because Chuen Lai has declared it for a cultural monument and or whatever. How he sold it to the comrades. So we have seen only ruins, but in Derge was very impressive. that I met Kenza Rinpoche, who was on the first time on the trip to his constituents.
How do you remember this encounter? How did you meet him?
Well, first, we were taking pictures of Derge Monastery, and then I saw a procession with baldachin climbing up to a temple. So I told my student, must be very high Lama, let's go there. It was Kenza Rinpoche sitting there naked, half naked, and his company was the French guy.
Oh, Mathieu Ricard.
Mathieu, I didn't know, Ricard, I remember. And so we could also talk, and he interpreted. And when I told them that I'm coming from Cologne, and a friend of mine is Tulku Tingo.
Yeah.
They said, Tulku Tingo, mm-hmm. Your friend, you're from Cologne. Then mm-hmm. One Tibetan in the company, would you take a letter for Tulku Tingo? I said, yes, why not a letter? It's not a yak or something. And so after about 1 hour, we were doing all possible small talk about what I don't know, I don't recollect. I got a letter from the culture department of Derge and took it to Cologne. When I arrived in the fall, I found Tingo that I have a letter I have received through Kenza Rinpoche for him, but the sender is the cultural department of Derge, or whatever the district is. So the other, next day, Tingo came along, read the letter and became very, very serious. Tingo, what's in the letter? They asked me to come back and to resume my seat in the monastery. They would give also the lands and so back to the monastery. So when do you go? Sorry, bloody. It's not easy. And of course, before I would give any reaction, I have to consult it with His Holiness at first. And then we had a very long discussion what it is to be a tulku, to realize one day that you actually don't belong to your parents, but to an institution, an organization, a monastery or whatever. It was very, very interesting. And it brought us, we knew each other for many years, but it brought us a bit closer together.
And so how do you remember Tibet from the 80s?
First, I was rechewing the trip many, many times through my exhibitions I made on Tibet, through my elaborated books, retelling the stories, the travel stories. So it's present around me. Above my breakfast table is a panorama of Kurla Mandata and the plateau around Lake Manasarovar and Rakhistan. So it's of course in very fresh in my memories. The long-term memory is still very good with me.
And what did you like in Eastern and Central Tibet? Which places?
Eastern Tibet was not my kind of Tibet. I was more or less, when we crossed the first pass after Kanding, I was quite disappointed. It was green, deep cut valleys, forested up to 4,500 meters. So even the passes where it crosses were not above the tree line. So, for me, real Tibet, as I was dreaming of it, started in Nakchuka. So I had no desire to return to Ham and to start a work on Ham. So I have been 3 times in Bhutan, but I would not go now again. It's not my idea of Tibet. That was Ladakh. As a substitute, you must imagine it took 11 years training in Ladakh to get first time to the proper Tibet.
And how did you find Central and Western Tibet different or contrasting to Ladakh? Or was it more an extension of Ladakh?
Western and Central Tibet, with the exception of Purang, is almost uninhabited. There are Brokpas, nomads. Sometimes it's 100 kilometers from one nomad group to the next one. So there is no comparison to Ladakh and Sanskar. So it was, as I told you, in 1986, I returned to Tibet with the intention to be accompanied by a refugee to experience how it is to return home. As I am myself a refugee in 1986, everybody was thinking communism is permanent for the next centuries. So I did not have much hope to go home one day. So I wanted to experience how it is to come home as a refugee in Tibet. Because thanks to Ladakh, I was quite familiar with the culture. And a friend of mine, Tsering Dholkar in Nepal, in Kathmandu, whom I met in Lhasa in 85, she promised me to find a refugee who could be my assistant and we could do it. So when I came in 86 to Kathmandu, she said, I have one nice guy for you. So I met Tempa Verza and we negotiated the terms, everything, how much he will get, when we would go, how is it with the documents and so on. And then he asked me, and where are you going to go? I said, where you are at home. So I'm a nomad. I said, yes. But from which part? It's from southwest Tibet on Tsampong. I said, and is there some of your family still there? He said, yes, two brothers and two sisters. And would you find them? Yes, of course. And I had to change my idea about nomads. They are not migrating from one place to other and so on, but they migrate between winter pasture and summer pasture. So yes, of course. So we go there. So we went there and visited his family. And it was strong.
So you traveled over the Himalayas from we traveled
first to Shigatse, and then by trucks we traveled to Lhatse and then Pariang. Is that Sakatsong? Yeah.
I don't know.
Sakatsong district. There is also a ferry across Tsangpo. So we crossed Tsangpo in Saka and had to walk for 2-3 hours, then reached the Teva group of nomads. That one, you know, you could not just found them. We are coming. Kill a sheep. And then we walked from there to Paikito and along Paikito back to Kathmandu Lhasa Road and back to. That was quite a short trip because I was quite nervous. A very close friend was dying of cancer. I had a feeling I should leave it with Tibet for now and return as quickly as possible. So I luckily came 3 days before she passed away.
You said that this trip to the nomads was quite strong.
To
the nomads with your friend. Yes. So why was it strong?
You know, until then, I was a bypasser of the nomads. It was picturesque to take the pictures of the black tents, some very adventurous looking faces and so on. But to wake up with them in the morning, to live among them, it's something different. And I was, for instance, very naive when the children always, when I open my box, very curious, you know, it's curiosity, looking what I do. One day I was sure they must have seen also the chocolate bars. So I said, well, it's your emergency food, but now you have to sacrifice one. So I took one and gave it to the mother in the next tent to me. There were 3 girls. And what is it? So I opened it. Then I broke it in pieces and gave 3 girls and the mother a piece of chocolate. Now they were watching. Then the smallest one tried it, spat it out and threw it in the fire. My survival kit. And the other one tried to pass it on the mother. You know. And then I realized I am the first long nose they have seen. How should they know what is chocolate? So everything is for them totally unknown, you know, and that they did not wash their fingers after and before every toilet. They had to get the bucket 1 kilometer walking, you know, and then rice is a commodity they have on holidays. Of course, they need samba, they barter it on the markets for butter and cheese. And it was interesting to see how they milked in the morning the trees, how they milked also the goats and then made curd and cheese, and a close-up of a very basic livelihood. And I was thinking quite a lot about nomads and settled ones. And they are surely loving their freedom more than any comfort. What an experience. Luckily, I was still young. and it happened to me.
So, among the many books you made on Tibet and the Himalayas, which one would be your favorite one, if there's one?
Yeah. Of course, there is the first one after my third trip, Tibet Gate to Heaven, with fantastic text by John Kay. Unfortunately, it never came out in English. We did not find any English co-publisher. So, but the first book edition Panorama made was Tibet. Only panoramas. But Tibet, looking back, the review, because it contains also my black and white pictures, should be my memento mori of Tibet.
And in the 80s, you also began your work in Burma.
It was 85, I was first in Burma.
Were you in touch with the Eris family, with Anton and Michael at this point, or not?
Well, I was. I knew even before that Michael is married to Aung San Suu Kyi, but I never met her during her time in Great Britain, in Oxford, because I never managed to get to Oxford for time reason. It was all I did in this field was beside my professorial job. But they were always telling about her, about the boys. And I met her only 2012, when she was, before the first election campaign, she was in the campaign, so I could present her my first Burmese book I made. I think it was 2014, and I met her. And last time I saw Michael was during and after the conference towards the definition of style in Vienna.
When was it? Okay.
'98, because at that time I started to work with Anthony on a book on the Apsaras of Angkor Wat, and must have been, because in 1999 it should have been published, and when I came back from Cambodia in mid-March, I phoned Anthony, and when he picked up, I heard only heavy breathing. I said, "Anthony, what's wrong? Are you not okay?" He said, "Not me, but Michael is dying." I said, "God, don't tell me." Now we are very silent on the phone. And he was diagnosed cancer in January. It was very, very quick, because I left end of January for Bangkok and Cambodia, and 1 week later they have birthday the same day as my daughter on 27 March. So that was also, I could see the difference between the two brothers when they were, and never mix them, only on telephone. They were indistinguishable. It was absolutely impossible to say on telephone who was Mike and who was Anthony.
So what did you like about Burma? You've kept returning there.
Well, pictures, pictures, mountains, rivers, and crazy Buddhists.
But it's very green. It's very different from...
Yeah, but the craziest. I still did not find any approach to Theravada. So I don't know anything, and I will not start reading much about it. I picked up something about Tibetan Buddhism while working with Roger Gopam. Khonchok Pandey is my closest friend for 45 years in Ladakh. So there are always questions discussed, and so I know a little bit, even if I don't believe in anything of it. And the Burmese Buddhists, they are this funny mixture in believing in the spirits, Buddhism, and building as madmen's Buddhas in all positions. You don't find a reclining Buddha in Tibet or in Ladakh, for whatever reason. You find standing and sitting, but no reclining. But in Burma, Zedis, stupas and Buddhas, they can't get. And the interesting aspect is that, like in India, maintenance, even in private other life, is totally aligned to them. They built a new Buddha 10 meters of it is the same size of Buddha, decapitated, and the head is still there. They just would need to set it on the neck, a little bit plaster, and repaint it. No, to make new ones. That gone. Well, it's extremely photogenic country. And also interesting stories. The funny story is that even in Theravada, the 8 rules of proper conduct are basic to the Buddhist belief. But not to kill is one of it. But the most famous king in Pagan in the 13th century, he led to behead one of his generals because he didn't deliver for 3 mornings, consecutive mornings, the flowers as a sign of respect. Oh. And that the king who wanted suppressed belief in spirits. How can the contradiction pass unnoticed by the believers that a Buddhist king let behead one of his generals for such a thing? But I think, meanwhile, I have only one place I would like to visit. I would go to Burma again, the jade mines in Bakant, in Kachin State. I was very close to it already 12 years ago, but since then I had no chance to get a permission.
And can you tell a bit about your work in Angkor? How did it start? And also, how did you work with Anthony Eris?
Anthony published the book on the bas reliefs that I documented by the slit scan technique in 1995. So he then spontaneously published the English version of the book. And because at the end of 1995, there was an exhibition in Musée Guimet on the reliefs with the photographs we took in the spring of 1995. So he joined the publishing. It was French, German, and English publication. And so he more or less only edited the English translation of the text, which was minor. It was not so much known. And actually, when we planned our trip after our graduation, my 2 friends, the goal was Angkor. Because my friend Miro Wolf, who studied architecture in Aachen, one day came across the books on Angkor by Grolier and Madeleine Giton. And he brought them home and said, "This we must see after we have finished here in Aachen." I opened my mouth, said, "Yes, we must." Well, but then we found out we cannot go by car, by land, up to Cambodia and we won't, and it was not far enough for 1 year trip. So that's how Africa came into the game. But as soon as the United Nations action for the first free elections after Khmer Rouge time started, and Cambodia granted visas, tourist visas. I was luckily sabbatical in that semester, so I asked some friends whether they would join me for a trip to Angkor. Roger Geba had just recently an exhibition Khmer art from private collections. And so in January 1993, we came to Angkor, and with open mouth I was walking along the bus reliefs in Angkor Wat. How to photograph it? It must be a nightmare. And in September before that, at the Photokina in Cologne, a Swiss camera maker who made the wrong shot cameras or slit scan cameras, he told me with enthusiasm, "Jaro, now we have the final panoramic camera. It not only can use interchangeable lenses, work from macro to infinity, it also can travel on a rail and photograph the wall continuously." And I started to laugh and say, "Herman, I need a reasonable camera for panoramas and not something like that." And he said, "Jaro, you are a creative man. You will find a project." Now, 4 months later, the bus reliefs. I walked, measured distances. And as soon as I came home, next day, I phoned to Switzerland. "Herman, could your bloody camera travel 100 meters along a wall with a relief between 2 to 20 millimeters deep, and in the naturally." So now I had a task to get the camera. 45,000 Swiss francs, 100 meter measure-made rail, 20,000 Deutschmark, and then a team, and so on, fundraising. But I managed to get the funding. I had a very good team of 6 students whom I promise when I get all the funding and we solve necessary some technical problems, you come for 5-6 weeks with me to Cambodia. There were some problems, the light you need, and but they were enthusiastically working with me for 1.5 years. In 1994, in the winter, I already got the camera purchased by the university, luckily. I got only 10 meters and I had to test it in Cambodia. We got a commission for a documentary on slit scan technique in Angkor for first channel here in Germany. So there was the tests were financed. Luckily, I did it this cautious way because the camera was not fit for tropics. It collapsed there. But we could repair it and so on. And finally, in February 1995, I was with 6 students, some friends, 800 kilo luggage on the way to Angkor. But luckily, in November before that, I had a good idea. When the pictures are sharp from left top to right bottom, then each area received the same identical illumination and exposure. So it means that the films, and it was on analog film, are suitable like satellite pictures to evaluate digitally. But if you want to evaluate numerically, digitally, such images, you must have a key. And the key can be done only by some restorer of stone. And luckily, at our university, we also had at the Department of Restoration and Conservation, stone conservation. So I have asked my colleague, Hans Leisen, whether he would be interested to join my project to investigate the surface of the reliefs. He did it. And out of it came then the German Apsara Conservation Project, which was quite special. The project of the Slitsken documentation of the bus race was to big part financed by the German government, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, who committed herself to participate in preservation of Angkor. In 1992 at the Tokyo conference, Germany said, yes, we contribute. But the Minister of Foreign Affairs could not find an institution which would be able and willing, not able, there would be some, but willing also to perform some project in Angkor. And Hans Leisen proposed conservation of the carved surface at Angkor Wat. So at the moment when Save Alchi project died, German Apsara Conservation Project came up, and yeah, I was co-director for the coming 10 years. And chief of documentation. And maybe I also made more detailed documentation of Angkor Wat than French ever did.
Yes, it's the most detailed we have.
Yeah, I think so. Lucky. So my last year at Berkeley, I made a presentation, 40 years documenting Asian art from Alchi to Angkor.
Yeah, great scope.
Alchi and Angkor, two poles. Mm. How lucky.
Yeah, it's wonderful. Mm. And now we can use all this work. Okay. Jaro, you also mentioned David Snellgrove.
Yeah.
Did you know him personally?
No, we met. We met in Siem Reap when Anthony Amarillo visited me, because he moved after his retirement also to Siem Reap. And so we had dinner with Arises and in our project house and Snellgrove, and I bumped into him for some time every morning when he came for a morning walk to Angkor Wat. When I rode my motorbike into Angkor Wat, I saw Mrs. Dargrove, but every time when I stopped and said, good morning, how are you, Mr. Snellgrove? And he always asked me, and who are you? So I have 4 or 5 times reintroduced myself.
And at this time in the 80s, in the late 80s, there was also the opening of Eastern Europe or the fall of the communist regimes. So you got the opportunity again to come to Czechoslovakia and then the Czech Republic. And you also worked there together with the first president, invited by the first president, Václav Havel, for an exhibition.
Well, it happened that end of 1989, Roger Gaber organized a big exhibition of the collection of Gerd Wolfgang S. called Gods of the Himalayas, Götterdes Himalayas. And Dalai Lama, on the way to Oslo to receive his Nobel Prize, made a stopover in Cologne. That was monthly. Then Havel became president, and in the exhibition went until February 1990. The next venue was Munich in September, October 1990. But they withdrew participation because no funding, no money in Munich. So the exhibition was free for almost 1 year. And when Václav Havel, in his New Year's speech, said, and I wish that before the first free collection in Czechoslovakia, Prague is visited by His Holiness, the Pope, Johannes, whoever it was, and His Holiness Dalai Lama. Oh, I was skiing with the family, with the kids in Switzerland. 1 hour later, my sister phoned me, have you heard it? I said, what? We are just having our New Year's lunch. I said, Havel invited Dalai Lama to Prague. Yes. Does he know who Dalai Lama is? But the first proposal to move the exhibition to Prague came from my sister. I said, don't talk nonsense. You know how devastated the country is. They would not even get a bucket of lime to whitewash the exhibition hall. So, yeah, but think of it. Maybe something can be done. Then I came back to Cologne. I received a phone call for the administrative director of Cologne Museums, whom I liked very much, we were friends. He said, Jaro, could the exhibition move to Prague? I heard Havel invited Dalai Lama to Prague. So I told him the same. Then Roger Gerber, what to do? So I said, impossible. But at that time, we had an invasion of Czechs here. So I had all the time mattresses everywhere and visitors from Prague. Also, the sister and her husband of my friend, I was traveling to Africa, was staying with me. And on a Sunday, when they were about to go back to Prague, I said, could you do me a favor? I would like to send Havel my book, Gate to Heaven, so he sees where Dalai Lama comes from, when he invited him already. And so, yes, we go tomorrow on Monday to Hradčín and drop the book there. So I sat down and typed a letter, dear Mr. President, I was very pleased to hear that you have invited His Holiness Dalai Lama to Prague. Since many years I'm engaged in photography and filmmaking and so on in Tibetan space. And 2 years ago I published the book Tibet Gate to Heaven, and I would like to donate it to you. And by the way, it would be a great pleasure for me when my first visit to Prague after 1968 would coincide with the visit of Dalai Lama. Yours sincerely. On Tuesday at 6, I came home from the university, telephone ringing, I pick it up. Can I speak? Are you Professor Ponsa? Can I speak in Czech? I said, of course you can. I still did not forget him. We have just went through your fantastic book on Tibet, and we are wondering whether you were serious with a comment that you would like your trip would coincide with the visit of Dalai Lama. I told what that was the secretary of Havel. I said, listen, when I sit down and write to head of state, I'm quite serious in everything what I'm right. So he said, the Dalai Lama is coming on 5th February or 7th February. And so I said, listen, that's good to know, but could you, I would come, but could you ask President Havel whether he would be interested that a Tibet show would be shown in Prague, which is now free in Germany? I pokered and said, the German side would pay for all in all involved hard exchange, foreign exchange. So I will call you at the same time tomorrow and let you know. And he said, yes, President Havel would be very much interested. I said, listen, then we have not much time. The opening should be at Easter time. And please take care that at the airport I meet a person who would help me to organize. I have to see the potential venues and so on. I said, okay, I will take care of it. So it happened that I flew on the same airplane with the Dalai Lama from Frankfurt to Prague, and descending 2 steps or 3 steps behind him, and security, of course, of us. And there was a man who then went around with me. My father was there, my uncle, whose car it was so depressing. It was terrible. I said, you were right. And pot with the lime would be a problem to get in. it was stinking sulfuric and so on. And there was only one place which would be possible to many, it was the Mahanes, the exhibition hall center of the Association of Czechoslovak Artists. So I told this man that is the only possibility. It was. So I gave up actually, and we went with my father and my uncle to Litoměřice, my first visit after 23 years at home. I said, forget about Tibetan exhibition. It's not so important. And of course, I wanted to give it a chance. So I phoned the secretary of Havel, told him what I found in Prague. I said, if Havel makes it to his affair, we get the venue in Mahanes. But I have to see Havel, talk to him about it, and then we decide. I said, okay, then if you can, come tomorrow at 4 to Lani, the castle. The president will be there to prepare the visit of Dalai Lama. So it was cold, but sunny, February. My uncle drove me to that place, and at the gate I gave my business card to give it to Václav Havel. After a few minutes, a chap came back and returned my business card. He said, the president asked you for apologies, to excuse him. He's now too busy with the preparations of visit, Dalai Lama's visit and so on. I was pissed. They asked me to come at 4, I come, and then I am not admitted. So, okay, forget about Tibet exhibition. And drove home with my uncle. We visited some other people I know. They knew me from before 68. And when we came home, it was around 8, 9 in the evening, had some beer already. And the neighbor came, said to my father, Herr Ponsar, police were here and were looking after you. And they left here some phone numbers you should call back. Huh? Did I make something wrong at immigration, or what's happening? And then I looked at the phone numbers and recognized the phone numbers of Havel's office. So I dialed one, and when I said, here's Ponsar, I was asked to call this number. Mr. Professor, we were looking, so a terrible mistake has happened. You were here and you have been sent off. Please stay at the phone. President will come immediately. Havel came breathless and said, help, Mr. Ponsar, something terrible has happened. We were just discussing something. Then a business card was passed to me. I see Professor Dr. Jaroslav Ponsar, physics, and so on, because I had on my business card that I Professor of Physics. So I said, now the Buddhists are on, the physicists should come later. And then Mr. Kolmash told me, Mr. President, wasn't it the business card of Mr. Ponsar we are expecting? So Ponsar, yes. Well, oh God, get him back. But I was pissed already somewhere on the way to Litomnesis. So Havel said, if you can excuse it, it would be a great pleasure if you come tomorrow at 4:03, I don't know the time. There will be a holy mass in the chapel, and after that we have tea time with some other people. So okay, so that's, I came again to the castle, Hani, and then I told, I had the catalogue from Cologne and everything, and I pokered. I said, Germany is really willing to pay all expenses in foreign exchange, and but if you don't have patronage of the whole affair and say you want the exhibition to have, he said, Havel, since I'm president, philatelists come and want me to take patronage over something, then a breeder of something come. Okay, there will be no rabbits, no. So, will you do it or not? So, yes, I will do it. So we have to start next week with the preparations. So it happened. We managed, but it was, what an experience.
And it was the first photograph on Tibet in...
So how I met Kolmash. Say hello to him when you, if you...
Yes, yeah, I will.
Should see him.
Yeah, that must have been very nice. And could you say more about how you've assisted in other visits of His Holiness in Europe, and also how you worked as a photographer of His Holiness?
Well, 1982, Dalai Lama came for study visit. It was declared for political reasons, you know, it, what's about with Chinese and so on. And when he came, there is a strong community in Bonn, Cologne region. So when he came in 1982, I was asked by the organization of Tibetan in Germany to photographically document His Holiness' visit. So I did it. And at that time, we also had the Aachi exhibition in Museum of East Asian Art. He visited it also. So that was for me also interesting to have small talks before the daily program started with him, and in the evening to say good night to him in the hotel. And we were visiting the Cardinal, done a lot of visits to the Buddhist center here, and so on and so on. So it was a very interesting program also for me. There was this time when the next visit, that was not visit, but very good memories I have, that when Dalai Lama was requested to be guest editor of the French Vogue. So the Vogue people, when they visited him in Dharamsala, brought as a gift my Tibet book. And the Dalai Lama picked up for the Vogue the panorama of the salt caravan in Purang. And I was very happy about it. But they also, the Vogue people, they took this panorama as the inside of the New Year's car that was a double folder. On the front, Dalai Lama, when he was a 5-year-old boy, and the wishes and so, and inside my panorama. And I have, of course, one signed copy here. Now I've seen him just a few months ago in Ladakh. He likes Ladakh like me. He's every year in the summer for some time. It was the most Tibet-like place he can visit. He's still with his health, okay? They only look after him when he's moving around, so he does not fall. But he's 83 now. And of course, the first, I must have told you, the first time I met him was 1976 in Ladakh. That was almost a 1-hour long audience. But I was not alone, I forgot the name, the correspondent of Newsweek, and Helena Norberg-Hodge. It was interesting because at that time, the rumors said that he is the last Dalai Lama and the Kala Chakra is the last one he's going to give. So that why all the press people came from Europe, from the East. And it was also interesting for me to hear what he replied.
And what did you talk about with him?
I was more listener because I was too shy. And but when the news correspondent asked about he is the last Dalai Lama or not, he said that it's without, for him, without doubt, that he will be reborn, but whether his rebirth will be searched for is another question. He thinks he could be here for another 40 years. Now he surpassed it. And if during the 40 years he makes the Tibetan feel that he is of use for them, then they also will search for his rebirth. In that sense, he answered. Was very, very sensible what he said. So the first meeting left a big, big impression.
So after working at so many places around the world, do you have a favorite place?
Such questions are always unfair.
Sorry.
If you know, the Alchi Sarspul area in Ladakh is the most beautiful spot of Ladakh, and I feel very, very comfortable there. even from many last visits, I did not visit the temples because the monks asked me entrance fee and selling plagiates of my postcards and everything. And then they not behave like real Buddhists. So I was last because I have accompanied somebody whom I wanted to show what I did there, how it is inside. So I paid the entrance fee. But the Likir monks are not the only nuisance of that kind. When I want now to enter the scaffolding in Angkor Wat, which I purchased for our project, they want also entrance fee for me in Angkor. The greediness is one of the properties you have to overcome to get a good rebirth. And in both cases, Archie and Angkor, the greediness is what is driving the people. Now, as long as they had no, almost no tourism, they did not care so much.
So you've also got to filming. What was your initial? Your initial dream?
Well, actually, it was Yemen that brought me to filming. Though, the first film should have become the expedition to Siachen Glacier. And as I had no money, I thought it could have been financed with the documentary on the expedition to the biggest non-polar glacier. But we did not have the permission to go to Siachen from India. The easiest way is Nubra and Siachen. But I found a man, a cameraman, who would be interested to do it with me. We became the closest friends and we made a lot together. And when we did not get permission from India for the year, for the summer in 1977, Wolfgang Kohl, a friend of mine, asked me, would you have some other subject? We could, I said, well, I am carrying on my mind since almost 5 years something I would like to film in Yemen. The way how they build the clay houses, it can't be photographed, it has to be filmed. So I have shown him my Yemen pictures of the construction techniques they call zabur. They smash the balls of clay with straw and then and fantastic. Yes, that would be surely interesting. And I say, okay. I ask a friend of mine who is a director in WDR, yeah, and maybe he has a tip whom we could contact. So I made a storyboard and some photographs, printed and went to see my friend. And he said, well, you could do it for me, Land Dimension Abenteuer. Countries, people, adventure. Just new serial that was co-started by him. And luckily he trusted, because I haven't done a meter of documentary up until that time. And he said, and your friend Wolfgang Kohl, he said, yeah, he's a freelance cameraman, but he has done for ZDF, the second channel, for your colleague, I named him, and so on. So, okay, so then make a proposal and an appointment, we see. So, at the end, the first film was on Yemen, we made. And he liked it, the friend of mine in the TV station. So when we came 1 year later with a Siachen from Pakistan side, and so he also stepped in, we made the expedition. Then Amarnath Yatra, 79, again, because they were quite successful, the movies. So at the end, I don't know, it became something. In Tibet, I made 90 minutes documentary, Tibet Gate to Heaven, and it was shown in one stretch, which is I'm proud of. And we also won the festival in Trento in 1988, best documentation. So the film, but then I stopped making films for two reasons. Too hard as a side job to my teaching. The budgets became tighter and tighter, and I did not want to switch over to video. So the Tibet Gate to Heaven was the last documentary I made.
And how is it different for you to be a filmmaker and a photographer?
Well, I learned quickly that film is not a sequence of stills. But luckily, my friend did not mind. Sometimes I had to take some stills. And so it worked very well. He is a very gifted cameraman. Have you seen some of our films?
A bit, yes, when it was shown on the Czech television.
Have you seen? It's
too long time ago, yes.
So I don't. It was translated into Czech.
I see. So I don't remember clearly, but I should look for it and watch it again. Yes, when I was small,
you can
I remember
download
it
from YouTube.
Okay, I will.
The
yes.
Tibet film. And also Ladakh and Winter Mansion, I think. They are on YouTube. Ladakh and Winter Mansion is the best movie we made. The was for ZDF. The best for WDR was Amarnath Yatra.
So please, could you tell a bit about your work in Afghanistan? That was one of your later projects.
Afghanistan was on my schedule in 1980. I was keen because I was keen to get to the source of Oxus, to Wakhan corridor. But then at Christmas time, 79, the Russians invaded Afghanistan. So I was more or less thrown back further east. So I was active. I made the film The Unknown Indus, and I 81 started Algae Project and so on. And my wife, who works as a exhibition project manager in Bundeskanzlei in Bonn, she worked on Gandhara exhibition, and at the beginning she should have received some object on loan, both from Afghanistan and Pakistan. But then Afghanistan withdrew participation, but she also organized the exhibition on the gold, saved gold, gerettete Schätze. And then when she was asked by the deputy minister of culture whether she would be interested to come as an advisor to Kabul for some time. And she said, yes, so-called Zimmerstelle. Now it's part of GIZ and so on and so on. And it was pushed back because they had the election. They took 1 year to get a government, and there was no appointed minister of culture who would sign the contract and so on. So when it came so far, I was meanwhile retired, and partners were not allowed to accompany the experts for safety reasons, for security, to Afghanistan. So the organization said, but maybe we find a job for your husband. And she said, he will be retired in July. So would he be interested to do a job in Afghanistan? Yes, photographic documentation of the cultural heritage. I can do it and train local photographers. So in October 2010, I went to Afghanistan for 1 year. The first time I was paid for photography. Photography was first time my job. Otherwise, it was always my hobby. Of course, I was always paid the journeys, but that was all because I did it as a duty of a professor. I never had holidays until my return. I was always on duty. Sounds strange, but it's so.
And you continue to be very active during your retirement.
I'm afraid if I would sit down for a longer, then I would not get up again. So I keep moving.
Is there still something you really want to do? Something you're looking forward to?
It sounds idiotically, but not. And I have to learn how to make holidays. Mm-hmm. And I still don't know the places I should learn. Let's see.
Do you like to revisit the places you photographed long time ago? Well, Ladakh you do.
I did, now after 45 years.
And do you like to see the changes, or how do you feel about this?
What I hate is the attitude of traveling visited human zoos. So I'm happy to see when the people in Mustang can get by cars, cooking gas, you know, when they get big glass sheets for big windows, that they can now afford also electricity. So I'm really appreciated all these changes. And in Ladakh, well, the people in Paris, they would also have the idea that 20 million tourists would disappear and keep the French as they were, maybe in times when Edith Piaf started her career. No, I'm not. I don't criticize. What was a good decision, a concept I made at the beginning was to travel to all these places first, and in the old days to travel in Europe. Because I think there will be no changes in the West because of our conscience to preserve the cultural heritage, but there will be incredible changes in the remote places. And it came so.
And then I have a few concluding questions. What would you say that your career has given to you personally?
I had an exciting life.
Yeah, definitely.
I was quite privileged. I'm conscious of it. Good karma.
So maybe you believe in karma.
I have suspicion.
You see?
I have a suspicion, but only suspicion.
And what did you find the most interesting and the most challenging in your work?
Oh, I could not pick one work I did. It was always, it was quite a challenge to set up the expedition to Siachen. It was probably quite idiotic to take a raft and go for rafting on the Indus. It was also, but again, a different thing to photograph 100 meters of a relief on one single photograph. There were many things that there was always a risk. Luckily, as a professor, I could afford this hobby. My life was a big hobby.
That's the best. That's the best.
Yeah, I could afford it. So the German taxpayer also could afford it.
And we are conducting this project also for current and future students of Tibetan studies. And would you have any advice for them?
I'm no wise man.
Okay, that can be